Welcome back to Morning Express. It is now 12 minutes after 8, and though late, we start off our person of interest segment. And like I mentioned earlier on, the person of interest this morning is none other than Nairobi County Senator, and that is Mike Mbuvi Sonko, who of course is known for various reasons, and some may say he's famous or infamous for one reason or the other, and part of that, of course, being the fact that he is seen to stand with the people sometimes to a degree that some would disagree with. And good to have you. Good morning, Senator.
Morning.
Good to have you. They say better late than never.
Everybody.
And maybe just for the benefit of those watching, because they are waiting, anticipating, you're late. And you know, they say that the punctuality is a mark of a disciplined officer.
I think these are some of the problems the county is facing today, Nairobi is facing today, the traffic snarl-up, the traffic congestion, the traffic
but
problem.
But as Senator, sometimes you guys have chase cars and sirens.
I agree with you, but today I think my bodyguards overslept today. One of them, the commander of my security, had his birthday yesterday. So this some of the reasons which...
Will they be fired?
No, I cannot fire them. It's normal. It's normal part of life. But the traffic congestion problem, it's very hectic. We need to look for think permanent solution to the problem we are currently facing.
I'll come audience. To you because I know you have declared that you'll be throwing your hat in for the gubernatorial seat come 2017 in Nairobi, and possibly solutions, especially regarding traffic. We'll come to that. But first of all, let me start, because of time, with a report that was released by the Mzalendo 2015, where it says that you, as Senator of Nairobi County, did not participate at all in any discussion, did not say anything in the Senate. Why was that?
I think that is untrue. In 2015, it's indeed true, there was a report that was released by Mzalendo Trust. But if I defend myself on that, I remember very vividly in 2015, towards the beginning of the year, His Excellency the President brought a dossier or a corruption report in Parliament, which was tabled by the President himself.
In which you were mentioned.
Which I was mentioned alongside with other cabinet secretaries. Mm-hmm. And although it was contrary to the Constitution, I decided to step aside. Mm-hmm. I was mentioned in the Kenya Pipeline dossier alongside with Minister Felix Chirchir. Mm-hmm. I decided to step aside for around 7 months to pave way for investigations to be conducted. I was cleared after 7 months. When I resumed the sessions, I think the first 3 days after I resumed, I lost my dad. I was again absent for like 2 more months. Mm-hmm. So when you look at the records, I was in 2015, I was absent for 9 months.
Okay.
But 2014, I was very active. Mm-hmm. The Hansard is very clear on that. 2013, I was very active. Again, in 2015, I resumed around December. I brought a motion in support of the war against alcohol on the president when he started this war against
illicit brew.
I brought a very, very, very sensitive motion in Parliament on the establishment of rehabilitation centers in all the counties. I brought another motion on the hawkers bill.
Okay.
I brought another motion on the establishment of ombudsman offices in all the counties. Mm-hmm. I also brought another motion on the rampant corruption in Harambee Stars. Mm-hmm. Which saw the exit of...
So in short, you're trying to say that you were active.
I was very active.
The time you are inactive is because you're out of office.
I was out of office for reasons which I could not avoid. Mm-hmm. By then, I was absent due to some avoidable circumstances. But
okay.
I'm normally very, very, very active in Senate.
Now, you seem to have toned down in terms of your style of doing things. Previously, you would be on the streets with the people, climbing walls on tarmac. What brought about the change? If at all, there is a change.
Okay, there is a change. But I don't want to go back to that, because there are sensitive issues to address the current issues Nairobians are facing, the rampant corruption. We have got so many problems today as a county
on what we are
facing.
So has your style changed?
What I want to say, everybody has a past. Mm-hmm. So let me forget about my past. Mm-hmm. I can say my style has changed, because I have to respect the people who voted for me overwhelmingly as their senator. I don't want to go back
to what happened. So I would be accurate in saying that your
style has changed. These are the things which I used to do when I was an MP. and I was elected as the county senator. So I don't want to go back to what transpired before I became the senator.
All right, let's tackle the
real issues facing Nairobians.
They say that the only way to tell, to predict the future is to look at the past, but okay, I'll let that be. But
I know you want to refer to my hairstyle, but I was, by then I was portraying a message to the international communities during the ICC cases. I had a banner, I think, on my head, telling people that our president is innocent, Uhuru is innocent. I had a peace message on my head. So that is self-explanatory. I don't want to go back to that.
Okay.
Because we don't have time.
Let's talk about your qualities as a leader. And one of the things that many people know you for is your generosity, which is a good thing, which is a fantastic thing. But they say the fastest way to fuel poverty is to ensure that those who are poor do not have solutions. What solutions do you have for Nairobi County? Not handouts. Because you're well known for giving out handouts.
But
what solutions do you have to make sure that Nairobi County is a better place to live in?
I have permanent solutions for the current problems we are facing. That is the joblessness problem, the poverty problem we are facing
today, the
idleness problem. But let me just come back to that. Kenya is a third world country. We are still under maybe I can say the poverty index. We are among the poorest countries in the world today. Mm-hmm. And let me tell Kenyans or viewers, I'll never stop giving handouts. I normally give projects to the people, but even if you give a project to a women group or to the youth, they cannot convert that project to be an income generating instantly. They still have to suffer. They still have to go to their workplaces. They still have to look for their daily bread. So whenever I've been giving projects, but I'll still continue giving handouts. If mingling with my people, this is what my critics are saying. It's giving handouts. They'll never change because this is a third world country. We are poor. Poverty is still there. Idleness problem is still there. Joblessness problem is still there. So whenever I give youth projects to the youth, I have to give them maybe some money to open
accounts. That is taking advantage of a desperate people, because at the end of the day, if I cannot have bread on my table and Sonko is going to put that bread on my table, even the Bible says that the gift of a man makes room for him. Isn't that compromising?
No, that is not a compromising situation. That is not taking advantage of the... These are the people who voted for me. Today, as we are talking, as we are seated here, I know there are women who are going to sleep hungry today because of poverty, because of lack of funds, because they cannot afford to buy food for their children.
And that is why, as senator and governor to be, to contest as a governor, that's why then you need to have solutions.
I have got permanent solutions, for instance,
which would sort out people rather than handouts, to have solutions that are going to outlive you. Because after many years, you may decide, okay, fine, I don't want to be in politics. But systems need to be in place that will remember Sonko.
Let me do a further elaboration on that. I've got agendas for the people of Nairobi. The things which maybe the current county government has failed us, unforgivable issues which they have failed us. For instance, I've said handouts of my... these are not handouts to me, but I can say it's empowerment to maybe the youth and women. But in my agendas, for instance, in maybe we talk about garbage collection, the county has really failed us. Our county is dirty. The garbage is not collected on time. But you see, I'm going to partner with investors, good friends of mine in Belgium. I've already identified a very reputable company. We are going to import or to partner with foreigners to bring in a giant recycling plant, which we are going to install in Dandora, where the current Nairobi dump site is. By bringing this plant, we are going to maybe to create employment to the hundreds of youths who are already there, who are relying on the Dandora dam site. Once we install or we bring this dam site, we are going to generate our own electricity to the tune of maybe 300 megawatts, which we'll sell to the national grid. We are going to maybe manufacture our own cash products, cash items like serviettes, toilet papers, which we'll sell to the great people of Nairobi. So the youths who are already there will have maybe a permanent employment. That will be a permanent solution to address the issue of the Eastlands youth in Dandora, who are hundreds in number. For maybe our women, we are going to give them maybe free loans. free projects.
Is it you as a leader of?
Maybe for instance, I'm assuming I'll be the next governor of Nairobi. Okay. These are some of the things I'll partner.
So those are some of the things.
Me and my, because my people, maybe some of my critics term me as maybe an illiterate leader. I was a illiterate leader, but I'm a graduate of KMU University. Mm. So the tactics which I learned in the university, I'm going to implement them on the what ground. I was taught in the university, I'm going to implement on the ground. So these are some of the tactics which I learned in the university, which I'm going to share maybe today with the viewers and. My namesake.
Okay.
The technocrats, the elites, I'm going to give them first priority when it comes to constituting of my cabinet, the county cabinet, or the county executive.
Okay. You mentioned traffic, yeah. And that's a problem that we seem to not get over. Even you are a victim of the traffic this morning, despite the fact that you have chase cars. I don't have a chase car, so if I was coming here, assuming that there was an accident on the road, I probably would have reached here at 11. If we look at the adverse effect, economically speaking, the man hours, the amount of fuel that we use, the amount of time wasted on the roads, traffic is a problem in this country and in this city. What solutions do you have?
Oh, they are saying time is money in Africa. Any second wasted, it's money. But to my primary solution, okay, we cannot solve this traffic issue immediately, but already we have some disadvantage on what the county government is doing. Nairobians, we are the highest taxpayers. We don't deserve to have. There was a time we had drums and roundabouts. Mm-hmm. We don't deserve to have drums and roundabouts.
The infamous drum
or concrete stalls and roundabouts. But what I can say, recently the county government was on record. They were saying they wanted to cancel all the PSV operators' licenses. That was wrong. There was a complaint from the Nairobi business community. But the only solution, as the maybe current senator, what I want to do and what I'm in the process of doing, I want to invite all the complainants, the business community, the stakeholders, the PSV, all the investors, stakeholders, traffic police. We have to come together on a roundtable meeting. We just tackle these problems. We have got the potential of solving this problem even before the next.
So do you have any ideas how?
I've got any. I've got.
What are some of those
I've
ideas?
I've got some of.
Because
of
as
the
much
ideas,
as you call the stakeholders,
for instance, immediately
probably looking at you for leadership.
God willing, when I become the Nairobi governor, I'm going to maybe instead of grabbing the land belonging to investors, belonging to Nairobians. For instance, we have a very big parking places in Nairobi, parking lots in Nairobi County. For instance, the parking opposite High Court, next to Rishwan Plaza, the other kind walk. We've got ample parking there, which at the moment, these parkings accommodate like 500 cars, the CIFA parking. But we're going to partner with these landowners. We bring investors. We do maybe a 16-story building. The malls which are in Dubai, some of the malls, they're not supermarkets or malls for buying items. They're malls whereby we have maybe a taller story buildings within the city,
okay,
whereby we can accommodate over 5,000 cars. Mm-hmm. If we have some parking lots in the city, each a parking lot which can accommodate over 5,000 cars, let's say we have like 10 parking lots by 5,000 cars, this is a 50,000 parking lots.
Okay.
That is already a solution to the current problem.
So you do have solutions
for instance, like now, if I'm the governor of Nairobi, what I'll do, I'll just call PSV operators, the business guys, the business community, the traffic officers. We agree, Uhuru Park belongs to the county. Maybe the county is managing Uhuru Park. Mm. All the matatus coming from Eastlands, we'll allow them to access CBD. Just drop passengers, go to Uhuru Park. All passengers will be going to Uhuru Park to board matatus. Instead of accessing town, when they are going to drop passengers in the estate, they come through Uhuru Park, Uhuru Highway, Mombasa Road.
Somebody
Eastlands,
might argue that Uhuru Park is a leisure kind of a park where people are there to relax and you want to.
But this is during weekdays. People relax during weekends. But during weekdays, we can use the parking as the. Maybe as a parking
as a
lot,
drop-off
point.
But I'm not
considered. I don't want to talk about distance only. Even from the maybe Githurai side, we have the Globe Cinema roundabout. Mm. From the other Udiru Kangemi side, we have the Westlands parking lot.
Okay.
Whereby we'll be repeating there. Same
all right, we're really are not doing well for time because I only had a short session with you this particular time. But I want to come to what happened recently, and you and the governor of Nairobi literally were almost involved in a fist fight, And of course, for those of us who are watching from home, who are horrified to think that our leaders can actually get into a fist fight, what was going on?
I think during that day, I think I was portrayed negatively by a section of the media.
Here's your chance to tell us.
But I think the governor is well known for this. We know the Tunoi saga, whatever transpired.
We would not like to bring that.
Okay, let me go to that. Let me talk about the saga. I've been actively participating in the Public Accounts Committee. I'm not a member, I'm just a friend of the committee. Whenever they bring any matter pertaining to Nairobi County, I have to be there, because I've been pursuing this maybe corruption matter since 2013. I've got my correspondences. I didn't come with my files today because of time. But if you keenly watch that video, and when we were in the boardroom, the governor and his executive members, over 10 people, they were on the other side. I was on the opposite side with the senators. There was a space in the middle. So I was just about to table my documents. I don't know under what circumstances the media were just outside. But when I was present.
Yes.
But when I was just about to table the documents to the chair, the governor came towards where I was standing. He told me, "You know, I can punch you." Governor himself, "I can punch you." I told him, "I'm not your son. I'm not your child. You cannot punch me." Then he was trying to punch me. Then I blocked his hand. In a few seconds, the media were forcing themselves in towards where we are standing. Then he changed the story. "Oh, Senator, you are my brother. You are my brother." But he's just a pretender. I've got the clips, and myself, I was just dealing with the issues we are facing as a county, because the bond of contention was the 2013-2014 Auditor's General Report. I did my research, I did everything, and I've got the correspondences, the letters with me. I remember very vividly the first days when the government, the county government, came to in control of the county. I addressed some issues when the Auditor's General Report was issued. I wrote to the governor. Pass one to Article 35, I wanted to be furnished with some of the information, because this report was in public domain, that corruption is rampant in Nairobi County. When I wrote to the governor, the reply I got, my friend, was a very bad reply.
Do you have a personal difference with the governor?
I don't. He's a very good friend of mine.
Friends don't fight.
He participated during my father's burial. I participated during his father's burial. We are good friends. We had some differences. We buried the hatchet. I even disbanded my Sonko rescue team.
Dad passed away. You actually
disbanded my Sonko rescue team, because I really wanted to work with him. Mm. My problem with the governor, the county government does not deal with the real issues Nairobians are facing today. Corruption today is rampant. We are defying the law. The law is very clear, that the Public Finance Management Act and the Constitution is very clear, that 30% of our total budget we receive from the national government through the exchequer, and the money we collect in terms of revenue, 30% of that must go to revenue, must go to development. We collect 9 billion. I mean, we are given 9 million by national government through this checker annually. We collect over 5 billion, that's 14 billion. But if we take 30% of that 14 billion to development, deal with road issues, water issues, we address so many issues facing Nairobians today, we will not have this problem which we are facing today. But the problem with us, corruption is rampant. Look at the Auditor General Report, my only bond of contention where our so-called fight started. The report on garbage collection, we all know that Nairobi is dirty today. But going to that report, there were some companies which were listed by the Auditor General, that they've been paid monies to the tune of millions, over 300 million. Those are some of the companies who are listed. I decided, when the governor didn't cooperate with the letter which I requested, person to Article 35, to have furnished with all these maybe reports, I decided to write to the Auditor General, the Control of Budgets, Minister of Devolution. I was furnished with all these documents.
Okay.
But so, going to these companies, I wrote a letter to the Register of Companies. I was furnished with the directorship, the physical addresses, the telephone numbers. I decided to call these
Some of the companies.
I had a conversation with the directors. I've got a safari company to prove this. I've got a certificate for the conversation I had with them. Some of the directors, when I called them, "Well, you paid this money, it's 40 million. 30 million, 20. They said, "Yes, we were paid the money, but we've never collected garbage since we established our companies." Mm-hmm. So then where did this money go to? They're telling me the money was paid to us, but the county officers came for this money. Mm-hmm. out of 40 million, we only made like 4 million.
Okay.
The rest of the money was collected by the county officers, and they had the instructions from the governor.
So your contention with the governor purely is because
I'm fighting impunity, I'm fighting corruption. He's my personal friend. I'm not fighting him as a personal friend. And people, when we used to raise these issues, people thought maybe I was just playing politics, but I want to be the next governor. But my correspondences are very clear.
Okay.
When I started raising these issues, mm-hmm. I had not maybe declared my interest in vying for the governorship.
Okay. Unfortunate that our time is up, and the director tells me we really have to wind up now because of other segments within the show, but I think there's a lot that needs to be discussed. There are several things that you've brought up that are very serious accusations against the county government.
Even before you wind up, on the rates, my only problem is on the rates. On the rates, the governor raised a question in Senate, in the parliamentary committee, that the Senate and the senator are not doing anything in helping the county to recover the billions the county is asking from the rate defaulters. Mm-hmm. But there, the governor was wrong, because I investigated this case. The rate defaulters, you know, for instance, this building belongs to KTN. Mm-hmm. The county can impose a fake rate claim, auction this building. But who are the buyers of this building? The governor's lawyer, and I'm not afraid to be taken to court. Governor's proxies, governor's cousin Emmanuel Okello, governor's lawyer Tom Onyango. These are the people who buy this property. They can be verified. I have got a pickup here down which has files to prove over 10.
It is not fair to accuse the governor of
that. I know you can be sued. You can be sued. I can be sued. We don't want to have another scenario whereby Jeff Koinange and Tony Gachoka were sued. Mm-hmm. Me, I've got documents to substantiate my allegation.
All right.
To explain my allegations, mm-hmm. that I want to repeat my remarks in Senate, although I pass on to Article 117 on the powers and privileges and immunities. Mm-hmm. Senator,
I have to cut you short, Sonko, because of time, and we really had an hour to do this, but because of time and because of the traffic issue, we were not able to do that. But definitely we need to follow up, because some of the accusations you've made here are very serious, they're very grave, and require for you to support.
I think I can swear an affidavit. Mm-hmm. I shoot a comprehensive commercial, a documentary or a commercial advertisement. I do it, then maybe I'll have to pay for my documentary to be aired
and wind it up right there. But thank you very much, Mike Sonko, for coming despite being late. At least we've managed to get some information from him, and thank you so much for your participation. We'll have to cut this interview short because of time, because we still have your money section, which is coming up. And remember, today we are converting Ashley Mazuri into a tout, and we'll find out how that industry works out and how you can also enhance and make your money work for you. Do stay with us right here on Morning Express.